something that you'd like to comment on or say or whatever, that you will unmute and break in. Don't let me just go on and on if you have something that you want to ask about. I'm going to have to. Okay, so what I did is I put up on share screen the main outline that we put up last week or last month. And it's based on the book, Social Justice is Not Biblical Justice. That I based the vast majority of this material on. This is an outline that the author has used to deal with what he considers the differences between the biblical worldview and critical theory on fundamental questions. And I'm just going to go down the left side here. We dealt with a couple of them is all we actually got to last time, which are what is ultimately real? Who are we? Third one is what is our fundamental problem as human beings? Number four, what's the solution to our problem? Number five, how can we be saved? Number six, what is our primary moral duty? Number seven, how do we know what is true? Eight, what's ultimate authority? And nine, is there a future final judgment? And then on this chart, what he does is he gives the two conflicting answers, what critical theory believes and what the Bible believes. And so what we did last time, we used this as our basic outline. And then I used a lot of material from a website by Neil Shenvey, who's been really following this whole critical theory, neo-Marxism, cultural Marxism, whatever name you want to give it. And he's just amassed a tremendous amount of information, largely by gleaning it from the writings of the critical race theory people themselves. And so what I did is I took this outline from the Christian Guy's book, and his name is Scott David Allen. He's the author of the book I just showed. I'm going to quote him a lot. And I mixed it with this material from Neil Shenvey. What Neil Shenvey did is he took tons of quotes from the critical theorists' writings. And boy, there is just a ton of that kind of stuff. And so we're going to hear from the critical theorists themselves on all these issues. And we're going to basically challenge those with biblical reasoning. Before I get started though, I just want to point out, who am I addressing with all this teaching? Who's the target of this information? And, you know, it could be that, you know, a bunch of us on the same team gathered together for a pep rally and ridicule the other side. Okay, no, that's not what I'm trying to do. I'm also not, my main target isn't even the critical theorists, those that buy into all this stuff, because they're not likely to be changing their mind anytime soon. My main target are the undecided, and particularly the young undecided, the youth, those that are going to be lambasted with this stuff when they walk onto the university campus, and particularly the youth that are that God has blessed us with, our own kids. And so, you know, the argument is kind of like, okay, we want to alert you of this danger. We want to give you a heads up on what this pagan, ungodly, satanic ideology is going to try to deceive you with. And we want to give you as much support in terms of a biblical response to it. So I just it's understanding in this subject can also be useful to basically combat those that are promoting the other view. Just wanted to clarify that. Also, one other little point I wanted to make before I get into tonight. Recently, I ran across a ministry, Christian parent ministry, basically a mother's ministry called Mama Bear Apologetics. And I just have a couple of comments about that. I'm not really a Mama Bear fan. The website shows mostly fairly young moms and puts a lot of focus on what it means to be a mama bear. And basically they say that the mama bear has two basic instincts, to nurture and to protect. And it even has a couple pages where it talks about how the mama bears growl. I wanna really emphasize how important it is for papa bears to be involved in apologetics. It's not really the mama's responsibility to protect. Maybe she has a primary nurturing role, but in the world of bears, once Papa Bear mates, he's out of here. He's a deadbeat. And so I don't think that's a very good example for us kind of strategize our apologetics. I really want to encourage dads to be involved in this. Discernment is necessary. Like I say, I'm not really big on the whole mama bear kind of mentality. So, okay. Since I can't quite figure out how to make my screen change, I'm going to bore you with seeing almost all my notes all night long. I had it somehow set up so you wouldn't have to see that, so you can shut your eyes when you get bored. Let's see. So here's where we left off. Now, what are you seeing now? Are you getting the whole screen, or are you getting a little piece with Bunny in the background? Somebody respond.
A piece with Bunny in the background.
Yeah, I can see Bunny in the background, but I can also see your notes. And we're seeing question number 3.
All right. Did we get rid of Bunny?
Yep.
All right. All right. Sorry, dear. Let's go. So we got this far last time on the general outline. So we're going through 9 questions that are answered differently by critical race theory and God's word. And the third one is, what is our fundamental problem as human beings? And the social justice view is, our fundamental problem is oppression. White, heteronormative males have established and maintained hegemonic power structures to oppress and subjugate women, people of color, and sexual minorities, the LGBTQ plus and others. Here's a quote from the book. And whenever you see these quotes, Scott David Allen, that's where I'm getting them, right out of here. According to CRT, critical race theory, white heteronormative males have accomplished this feat over centuries by establishing a complex web of social structures, systems, institutions, laws, and norms that advantage them at the expense of everyone else, particularly people of color, women, and sexual minorities, the LGBTQ plus group. This guy I'm not real familiar with, but he's one of the CRT folks. He says, the power of domination and exclusion is central to the belief in being white. I just admitted, Pete, I don't know if you had that ability or not, Barnes, but okay, so the power of domination and exclusion is central to the belief in being white. And without it, white people would cease to exist for want of reasons. Whiteness is an existential danger to the country and to the world. I'm going to hear a lot of pretty far out quotes similar to that. According to critical race theory, oppressor groups subjugate oppressed groups through the exercise of hegemonic power. I hope the name Antonio Gramsci is still in your memory. We met him last spring when we were going through the material on cultural Marxism. He was the Italian communist that was imprisoned in Italy in the 1920s. And he's credited with taking Marx's basically economic theory and extending it to pretty much all areas of culture. And he's mentioned that we're gonna see his name pop up again. The first quote I've got here now from Neil Shenvey's website is taken from Is Everyone Really Equal by CRT experts Senso and D'Angelo. And it says, in any relationship between groups that define one another, men, women, able-bodied, disabled, young and old, the dominant group is the group that is valued more highly. Dominant groups set the norms by which the minoritized group is judged. In Neil's website, he lifted this little chart from one of the CRT writings, and it shows how, well, let's go through the chart. We have on the left, the minoritized target group, and on the right, we have the dominant age group. And the type of oppression is in the middle. So basically what CRT does, it looks at all of these groups and imagines this relationship of oppression, the dominant group in racism are whites, everybody else is in the target or victim group. In the oppression of classism, we have the owning class oppressing the poor working class and the middle class too, evidently. And by the way, I'm not even gonna use this word, biological men. This cis thing, one of the things that CRT has done is they rewritten the dictionary to promote their views. And it's just like, we say gay now instead of homosexual. I don't think they invented this word, sis, but they sure like to use it. So basically the oppressor are biological males through sexism they oppress women, transgenders, gender queers, and probably a whole alphabet more. That oppression is called sexism. Then the heterosexuals are the dominant class that are guilty of heterosexism, which basically oppresses gays, lesbians, bisexuals. I'm sorry, I don't know what a two-spirit is. And then, of course, Christians are a dominant group that is guilty of religious oppression, and in case of the Jews, anti-Semitism. And the victims are just about every other religion. And then they throw in this able-bodied oppression of disabled people. They invented a new word for that one, ableism. It's a form of oppression. And then citizens oppress immigrants through the oppression of nationalism. And historically, white settlers have oppressed indigenous peoples through colonialism. So basically, critical race theory looks at all of these social relationships, looks throughout history, and it comes up with a pretty ugly picture. As a matter of fact, one of the problems with CRT is it doesn't have any kind of workable solution. It presents a pretty hopeless situation. And so this premise can pretty much only go one place: hate and despair. Critical race theory creates victimhood everywhere. Victimhood is crippling. No one really cares. Who really cares? Because this is the thing, you know, for 70 years now, no longer than that, since the Great Society, since Lyndon Johnson, the war on poverty, the liberal politicians have claimed a status of savior for all the economic and racial and now sexual victim classes. And critical race theory just eats that up. Victimhood is seen everywhere, but the problem with victimhood is crippling. And you've heard some of the, particularly some of the Black conservative politically activists who are pointing out that the slavery created by the Democratic Party through its welfare system is almost as bad as the slavery of historical times in America's 19th century, because this dependency it creates. No one who really cares would try to convince someone they are a victim. Ask Candace Owens. So I know some of you are familiar with Candace. She's proof that critical race theory is wrong. Individuals can and do think for themselves independently from their group identity. More on that question number three. This one is from White Fragility. Not my favorite book. These books are really depressing when you try and read them. Anyway, Robin DiAngelo says, whiteness rests upon a fundamental premise. The definition of whites as a norm or standard for human and people of color as a deviation from the norm. So the assumption is that deviation means inferior. I got a Chinese grandson. He knows he's different from his five brothers and sisters, but he doesn't see it as superior or an inferior. In other words, the whole idea that different is automatically a distinction of inferiority or superiority is bogus. So critical race theory's emphasis on group identity differences is causing a great increase in grievance, strife, hatred. It fuels the mob. And so, you know, this whole perspective of seeing the relationship between groups as oppressive is such a depressing, negative perspective. This one is from, like I say, go ahead and unmute if you have some comments or questions. This one is from article, Education and Hegemony, the Influence of Our Old Friend Antonio Gramsci. And it's quote here, in common usage today, hegemony might simply be used as a synonym for dominance and supremacy. Concepts of hegemony enable us to appreciate how dominant groups manipulate symbols and images to construct common sense and thereby maintain their power. Such groups increasingly are defined and understood not only in terms of class, but also in terms of gender, race, sexual orientation, and so forth. Common sense is in quotes here, because what they're referring to is the idea that the dominant group declares what's common sense and the oppressed groups go along with it. That's the whole concept of hegemony. And that's the gift that came from writings from a prison cell by Antonio Gramsci, took Marxist thinking and greatly expanded it. One of the hard facts of life denied by critical race theory and appreciated by men's like, and again, I'm using some more examples here. These are Black economists that are conservatives. You're not supposed to be a conservative if you're a Black person. Thomas Sowell, Walter Williams, Booker T. Washington in the past. These really good, very articulate thinkers, they contend that common sense is real. There are common values, there are common virtues, that we can, whatever our social identity is, it works for all of us. And it's not a power play by the dominant social group. So that's another postmodern supposition that we need to challenge. More on number three here. This one is.
Let me jump in here for a second, Dan. I could see Parnell or somebody out on campus preaching, and what they're preaching is something like, you've let the university pseudo-intellectual newspeak convince you that you're part of an afflicted or a suffering class of people. You've let the university redefine terms that eliminate normal, common sense, getting along with one another, and place everybody at odds with one another. Opening salvo like that out on the mall when the spring comes and the grass is green and the sky is blue, you'd have to have that practice down real good, but I think it would be a striking conversation that would generate. Are you a victim? Have you been convinced by the university that you're a victim? that you're in a suffering class of people? You know, are you black? Are you a victim? Are you a handicapped? Are you a victim of people who are not handicapped? Are they victimizing you? Is that what you want to learn out here on this campus? The Word of God says, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. The Word of God says, it's setting people free from the labels and the classifications and the cubicles that people are shoving people into, and from the hate and the rage that they have for one another. But you're caught up in this, and you think, and you pay good money for them to tell you these things. And I'm just supposing a open-air preaching situation where you could confront this openly on the campus. Because I think that this needs to be confronted openly. What they're doing is they're setting all the parameters. Their definitions, they have interpreted and defined all the boundaries of the argument, and there's really hardly any way to refute it other than to stand up and say, free yourself from this tyranny of oppression that they're putting upon you, you know? Anyhow, this is just my thoughts at this moment.
Yeah, I mean, to just ask and think it through, what are the consequences? What are going to be the results of thinking according to this critical race theory? You're going to tear the country apart. Actually, it's already, we got all kinds of evidence already. But to challenge that and say, you know, isn't there a better way of dealing with these things than constantly? I'll tell you what, this will come out more as we go through it when we start talking about the points in the outline that deal with how do you solve these problems, because the critical race theory has no solution. It basically calls for revolution. It's a bottom. The end result of critical race theory is anarchy. So, yeah.
Small little groups, everybody's in small little groups fighting against each other for their rights that the other group has taken away from them. It can't be anything but tribalism on the bottom line. Our tribe, we believe that we're free, you know, and we believe that you're oppressing us. And you get down to the smaller and smaller little group identities. Tell you, this presentation is alarming to me, Dan. It's alarming.
So, you know, what's interesting is like they're going to shoot the goose that laid the golden egg, because the only worldview that does provide a solution is the biblical worldview. And if you allow, so what happens if Antifa and Black Lives Matter take over? By critical race theory's own argument, the new reigning power will impose their new hierarchy of race, class, and gender. And there'll be a new revolution against that. There's only one worldview that, when it's followed, does not oppress other groups. And that worldview, the biblical worldview, that's what's under attack by critical race theory. So, you know, add that to if we're giving Parnell some ammunition here, add that to it. the biblical worldview is the one that's going to solve the problems of oppression. So we need to challenge the social justice crusaders by pointing out the logical consequences of their theory, even if they don't believe in logic, because that's what the postmodern influence does to it. This one is from The Complexity of Identity, Readings for Social Diversity by Beverly Tatum. She says, people in the U.S. are commonly defined as other on the basis of race or ethnicity, gender, religion, sexual orientation, socioeconomic status, age, and physical or mental ability. By the way, one of the things that really is dishonest about critical race theory is the way they bunch everything together. Areas that are, you social identities that you have by means of free choice are lumped together with social groups that you are part of through no choice of your own. They're all treated the same. What happens is this is the whole transgender, homosexual agenda and so on is basically a stowaway into this whole social justice cause, because where there has been real oppression, these other causes are, they got the big umbrella. Anybody you can imagine that has any kind of gripe can join this grievance. Each of these categories has a form of oppression associated with it: racism, sexism, religious oppression, anti-Semitism, heterosexism, classism, ageism. Hey, Bruce, are we victims? Well, ageism? I don't know. I think we ought to divide the church with those young, whippersnappers. And don't you feel oppressed? That's what they would want us to do. And dominant, systematically advantaged by the society because of group membership and groups considered subordinate or targeted, systematically disadvantaged. Other means other, not inferior. Critical race theory has now got no authority to rewrite the dictionary. You see what they're doing? They're just adding all this meaning based on their bias. We should challenge their claim of authority on every point. All right, a couple more here. From The Cycle of Socialization, Readings for Diversity and Social Justice. Dominant or agent groups are considered the norm around which assumptions are built, and these groups receive attention and recognition. Agents have relatively more social power and they can name others. Agent groups include men, white people, middle and upper class people, abled people, middle-aged people, heterosexuals, and Gentiles. The problem is there's a little bit of truth in some of these observations that they construct their theory from. And the mentality can be kind of seductive to young people. And so without a biblical foundation, and which is going to mean 999 probably out of every 100 freshmen at the U, they're toast. And even the Christian kids, they're going to have a lot of temptation to buy into some of this stuff. So, America, it's not won or lost at the polls, it's won or lost in the classroom. And I got some material hopefully we'll have time to cover tonight where we're talking about what how the critical race theory has infiltrated the classroom in Minnesota. This one is from Language and Silence, Making Systems of Privilege Visible. Stephanie Wildman and Adrian Davis say, examining privilege reveals that the characteristics and attributes of those who are privileged group members are described as societal norms, as the way things are and what is normal in society. This normalization of privilege means that members of society are judged and succeed or fail, measured against the characteristics that are held by those privileged. According to CRT's own thesis, we're condemned to this vicious cycle of one dominant subjective group replacing another. Couple more. I'm not going to read the reference for all of these in the sake of saving time.
I think, and
yeah.
Couple thoughts, you know.
Yeah.
You know, if I was hearing some of these arguments in a classroom, for example, I might, you know, one method would be just to point out, well, just because, you know, the group that has the greatest influence or the greatest wealth or the greatest power in a society, say the majority, determines the norms, doesn't guarantee that those norms are bad. And so we have norms in our society that are good norms, you know, and those norms have been put in place because the majority in our country were Christian when they put those norms in place. And so, you know, as it goes with the Constitution, you know, we have a form of government that was put in place by the majority, and yet it's created the freest, most prosperous country in, you know, that we know of. So, you know, what are you proposing to replace Christianity with? What are you proposing to replace the Constitution with that is better? Because I will argue with you that whatever you want to replace it with is not better. If we look and then we just compare their, you know, Christianity and capitalism or and the Constitution to Marxism, say, okay, let's look at how much death and murder and oppression has happened under Marxism, where you're getting these philosophies from, compared to, you know, this society. And it's been far worse in those societies, you know. And so I'm sorry, but I don't agree with you wanting to change these norms because I think the norms are good.
You know, corollary to this is the history that the typical youth has. And I'm going to go right into that. You just gave me the introduction to the next section here. Because you got to have true history to be able to argue what you're arguing, which is, yes, America is blessed beyond any country in the history of the world due to the Christian influence on it. Well, they're not getting that true history anymore. And so, you know, matter of fact, let me go into that. That's where we're headed next. The newly discovered understanding of oppression replaces the old-fashioned, outdated concern for totalitarian oppression like that of Stalin or Mao. I think a while back we took a look at what are the youth getting today in terms of their knowledge of communism, for example. Remember that article from Teen Vogue? So, you know, part of what you're going to have to do, Barnes, from your approach, you're going to have to re-educate them on the true history of America to be able to show that, you know, the typical kid today, as a matter of fact, we're going right there. Was it the 1619 project, rewriting the whole history of this country, portraying the founding fathers as a bunch of selfish slave owners, portraying the history of America as one of just awful oppression throughout its 250 years or whatever we have so far. So anyway, so this new oppression, as it's described by critical race theory, it replaces the old time. I mean, no one even knows about Stalin or Mao, but they know about all the oppression that America has committed. And guess who shows up when it comes to this? It's now holier to resist systemic oppression in America than to resist actual totalitarian dictatorships in North Korea, Cuba, or China. Even though these regimes actually kill people. And here's the current, you know, icon for basically critical race theory and revisionist American history, our friend AOC. And like I said, probably the only picture you'll find with American flag in her. It's trendy to hate America at the same time to ignore Cuba, China, North Korea, and all of the historical atrocities of Soviet Union and so on. So I gotta share with you a thing I got on the email about a month ago. And this is kind of the counter of AOC. Brand new congressman from Florida named Maria Elvira Salazar. Personal letter I got. Do you see that? Hi, Dan. I'm Maria Elvira Salazar, the newly elected congresswoman for Florida's 27th district. We need her. We need people like this to break the mold of the stereotyping done by critical race theory. She says, I'm a first generation American. I grew up on stories of the oppressive communist regime in Cuba, led by the cruel dictator Fidel Castro, from which my parents and many from our community escaped. This experience forged me in the importance of liberty and profound pride for the United States of America. But it also proved to me the fragility of freedom. This passion, by the way, I understand this is a campaign propaganda piece. I don't mean by propaganda, it's not true, it definitely is. We don't know everything about this candidate, but I like what she's saying here. But it has proved to me the fragility of freedom. This passion for the pursuit of freedom led me to a career in journalism where I interviewed a wide range of notable social and political leaders. I uncovered and exposed communist and socialist regimes in Latin America. I even stood face to face and challenged Fidel Castro on national TV. I've never wanted to be in Congress, but I knew that the policies of Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, and Democrat socialists across the country were espousing what they were espousing would make this country look more like Cuba and less like the American dream my parents fled oppression in search of. That's why a group of us new representatives have decided to form the Freedom Force to challenge the squad, right? To challenge the radical left and bring new voices to the Republican Party. We're representatives who aren't afraid to defend the American dream, and we have deep commitment to freedom and liberty. Support the Freedom Force. Who makes up the Freedom Force? or all freshman members of Congress with diverse backgrounds, careers, and stories. Some of us directly fled Soviet regimes. Others of us are first generation Americans whose parents fled Castro's Cuba. What are we fighting? Socialism in America. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and her socialist squad continue to push their radical agenda on the American people and lead us on a path that will turn the American dream into a socialist nightmare. We're putting together the Freedom Force to defeat that dangerous socialist rhetoric in Congress, the media, and online. Probably should add the education establishment. We will be in the trenches for the new Congress, challenging AOC and her radical socialists at every turn. We will not let America fall to socialism, but we can't do it alone. AOC squads is well-funded, online-focused, and rapidly taking over the Democratic Party. We need your help to build a grassroots army of like-minded patriots who will support our fight. So she wants some money. So note that Maria is not a victim. So one, a couple more quotes. Heterosexism is the institutionalizing of heterosexual norm or standard, which establishes and perpetuates the notion that all people are or should be heterosexual, thereby privileging heterosexuals and heterosexuality and excluding the needs, concerns, and cultures and life experience of LGBT people. So the heterosexual norm is not a social construct. It's based on nature and it's based on divine revelation. You know, we retreated from that. Christianity is repeated from that. Republican Party is, I don't think they ever took that position, but they're not going to take that stand. But we need to. History demonstrates that nations and cultures that abandoned the heterosexual norm, which is under attack here, they decline into depravity and self-destruct. I mean, that ancient Greece, ancient Rome, maybe you could even say 17th century France, I don't know, but there's a lot of cases can be made. But here's the big one. Sociological research clearly demonstrates that the heterosexual lifestyle is statistically more likely to include unstable social relations, drug addictions, mental health problems, suicide, and other social maladies than heterosexual relationships. That information has been around for a long time. It's been suppressed, if you get in, you know, this might not be one where, you know, somebody like Parnell can deal with in a group setting, but on a one-on-one setting, I mean, you need to let the young people know, boy, this homosexuality is a cancer to any nation, to any culture. And there is statistical support, all kinds of statistical evidence to support that. Here's another one. First, in considering oppressive theory, the question, what is sexism, is addressed through a definition that combines prejudicial attitudes or beliefs with social power. Suzanne Farr defines sexism as an enforced belief in male dominance and control, held in place by system of power and control that ultimately keep women subordinate to men. These systems of power and control take place in institutional, cultural, and individual levels. So, you know, part of the reason we lost this on a large scale here in this country is because That's what happens when Christians are ashamed of the Bible. The church has been intimidated by the feminist movement. And I think it'd be hard to even find in born-again Christianity a strong effort to combat feminism. It's just crept right into the church. But the Bible clearly describes roles of men and women. And there is not to be equality of authority in the family. Ephesians 5, it's there. It's still there. It was there back when Larry Christensen wrote The Christian Family. And it's still there after all of the caving that the evangelical church has done in the time since then. And like I said a couple times before in some of my teachings, patriarchy is not a bad word. Matter of fact, I spent some time today looking up on my Blue Letter Bible app where the word patriarchy is used. And it's always used as a good word in the Bible. And it's not apologized for. So we need to take the same attitude. Marcuse, I think he was a homosexual, actually, personally. Maybe not, but he definitely was politically pro-homosexual. Marcuse's notions of a one-dimensional thought complements the critical theory tradition to better understand how hegemony as cultural domination normalizes and sustains political economic power of particular historic blocs. The ruling coalition of economic, political, and cultural elites. So Marcuse was one of the, remember those group that came from Frankfurt, Germany, and reestablished themselves at Columbia University and Berkeley, the Frankfurt School. He was one of the leaders of that school. That, the Frankfurt School is the parent of modern critical race theory. The bias of Hauke, here's where I wanted to connect what we were talking about, what Parnell brought up. The bias of higher education, including the so-called sciences, is white and male, racist and sexist. Okay, science, it, even science now is white and male, it's racist and it's sexist. And this bias is expressed in both subtle and blatant ways. Sexist grammar burns in the brains of little girls and young women a message that male is the norm, the standard and central figure beside which we, meaning girls and women, are deviants, the marginal and dependent variables. So according to this view, the Bible is sexist, and we've heard that now for a number of decades, trying to rewrite, retranslate the Bible, take out all the male pronouns, make God our mother. And a lot of Christians are influenced and deceived by this rhetoric. Having a position of subordination is not oppression. Now, that's clear in the Bible and in traditional Christian teaching on family order. Subordination is not oppression. Satan and Adam were created subordinate to God. They both rejected it, and the Bible calls it rebellion in both places. Both cases. So subordination. I remember years ago, I don't remember an awful lot of the content, but it was along these lines. Ern Baxter gave a talk entitled "The Importance of Being Number Two." And he wasn't talking enough about wives and husbands. I mean, he brought that in. But in our relationship with God. It's so important to recognize we are subordinate. Satan couldn't do that. Lucifer couldn't do that. And that's the beginning of all our troubles. Adam couldn't do it. So after we throw out the modernist bias of higher education, which believed in objective truth, logical reasoning, and scientific truth, we end up with the postmodern bias of higher education determined by critical race theory. We see the results of that in political correct speech intolerance on the campus. So here we go, racism. Anybody want to throw anything in at this point? I'm trying to head to where I wanted to deal with this thing on education here. So I'm kind of stepping up the pace a little bit here. Racism, like other forms of oppression, is not only a personal ideology based on racial prejudice, but a system involving cultural messages and institutional policies and practices, as well as beliefs and actions of individuals. So like, remember Bodie Bachum, when we played his video last spring, he says, yeah, now you can have racism without an individual racist. According to this, all white people are guilty of racism by virtue of their whiteness, no matter what they believe, no matter what they do. So critical race theory provides no route to a solution. Scott David Allen says, ideological social justice destroys civil, humane society, replacing it with division, hatred, and tribalism. Furthermore, he says, in this worldview, evil does not originate in the human heart. Rather, evil is sourced outside of man, in society.
So the solution that they recommend, they actually provide, I guess, I don't know, their avocation for a solution is transfer of power. So we have to demonstrate articulately why that transfer of power is unjust and unreasonable. Transfer of wealth, transfer of capital. Why is that unreasonable and unjust? That's what we have to demonstrate. I guess their route to a solution is the state, you know, as a means to transferring that power and that wealth and that the capital, this, the whatever.
Typical Marxism. Yep. And with some of the other answers to these nine questions, that's going to fill in, and we'll see a more clear picture of the conflict between the Marxism and Christianity. Let's see, did I read this last quote there? This worldview does not originate in the human heart. In the CRT worldview, evil does not originate in the human heart. Rather, evil is sourced outside of man in societies. Everything is systemic, okay? And specifically in social structures, institutions, laws, cultural norms that perpetuate inequalities and grant one group power and privilege at the expense of another. So, you know, this should really set alarm off in any Christian. The worldview that evil does not originate in the human heart. All sorts of alarms should go off. Should be a major red flag for Christians. The Bible makes it clear. This is not a Bible quote, but it definitely paraphrases a lot of what the Bible says. The heart of the human problem is the problem of the human heart. And it's a major problem today. Too many kids do not know basic Christian doctrine like this, and they're defenseless when they hear this CRT stuff. The leaders of the social justice movement are not solving problems. They're causing all kinds of problems. And, you know, that's kind of what you were saying earlier, Parnes. You know, that's something we got to help, you know, the neutral, I guess there isn't such thing as neutral, but those people that are unaware, to warn them that the consequences aren't going to, of the CRT, are not going to solve any problem. They're causing problems. Like all Marxist revolutions, in spite of what they want you to believe, the leadership of the social justice movement does not come from the oppressed groups. Karl Marx and Vladimir Lenin were not from the working class proletariat. They were middle class academic intellectuals. The same is true for the modern social justice revolutionaries. Now, a lot of the authors and the professors of critical theory are people of color. But for the most part, they're products of academia, not of the experiences that they had. Matter of fact, most of them didn't start really from a low-class economic background. They're phonies, just like Bolsheviks were. Critical theory was not born in the ghetto. It was developed in the ivory towers of academia. The impetus for social justice revolution comes mainly from university professors who make a career out of encouraging certain identity groups to think of themselves as victims. So that's a message that I think we can, use to, try to get I'm trying to think what to call the undecided. Let's call them the undecided. The people that are, being courted by critical race theory. You get a lot of freshmen. It isn't so much now as it was maybe 30, 40 years ago, that come from small towns. Most of them now are coming from suburbs. But, for a lot of them, there's still enough tradition that when they reach the campus, you might consider them as undecided. And this might be one of the arguments we can do to help them not be persuaded by CRT. For example, social justice advocates encourage minority groups to be nationalistic rather than to assimilate. And what do we mean? Nationalistic means you maintain your loyalty to your ethnic group. Assimilation means you join the mainstream American culture. It used to be called the Great Melting Pot. Well, CRT is anti-Great Melting Pot. It encourages minority groups to stay minority. Example, speaking Spanish rather than English. Ask the obvious, which would benefit immigrants more? To maintain, Spanish as their primary language? How many jobs are they going to get? Okay. And which do the immigrants themselves want? So we talk about, the Marxists come along and they tell the proletariat, they even tell them what you really need and we'll get it for you. Against their best interest. Why are all the boats leaving Cuba? I always used to think of when Doc Noble used to describe this, that dry humor I sure miss. But, which way are they headed? Not just Cuba, but Mexico, Central America. They're all headed north. Why? My own background, I grew up.
Because they want to be oppressed, Dan. They're coming here. They're flocking here for our oppression.
amazing, those obvious things. You know, this is it's almost like critical race theory professors have got a spell on freshman classes. They can't see the obvious. You know, why are people coming to America? So that they can bring their little tribal culture with them, or so that they can participate in the American dream. I grew up in a small town in Illinois, and we had a large population of Mexican Americans. And I never thought of them as Mexican Americans. They were just my friends, as Americans. That's called colorblind in the critical race theory. And it's an affront to critical race theory to talk like that, because that means you're denying all the oppression that is all around us. So, but critical race theory, like the communist Politburo, thinks it knows better what is good for people than the people themselves. All right, that was question number 3, I think, was it? Yeah, we're only on, oh my goodness, we are not going to finish tonight. And the biblical answer, if you still have one of those charts, all have sinned, you know, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Our rebellion against God has resulted in broken relationships between God and man, between man and his fellow man, and between man and creation. So that's what our problem is. Question 4, what's the solution to our problem? So back to that main chart for our outline. The social justice view says the solution to our problem, revolution. Oppressed victims and their allies must unite to unmask, deconstruct, overthrow these oppressive power structures, systems, and institutions. Got Alan
sounds like,
says.
Sounds like the real insurrectionists.
That's exactly, yeah.
Sorry for the political statement, but you know.
Ideological social justice seeks the overthrow of systematic white supremacy, the patriarchy, Judeo-Christian morality, and just about everything else has made America great. CRT is Marxist. Marxism is ruthless. Again, it's like, man, if these kids don't know about Stalin's purge, about Mao Zedong's cultural revolution, about the gulags, about the, you know, mass murder. It's like, they got to know that for us to make a case. And CRT and the whole left-leaning university campuses have basically, you talk about suppression, they've suppressed a lot of truth. But Marxism is ruthless and it's fanatical. Whether it's the Marxists of Lenin in 1917 or CRT now, we see that with the Antifa riots and things like that. There's no room for mercy. Social justice movement, just like its parent Marxism, is ruthless and fanatical. And the longer it gains power, the worse it's going to get. So what are the social justice tactics?
So Dan, my thoughts, you know, the idea, like when you make an argument to a student, for example, say they're influenced by social justice, but maybe they had a Christian background or something. I don't know. The problem is if they're not born again, their nature is fallen, right? And depraved, and the lust for rebellion is in the human heart, you know? And so I think that unfortunately, that doesn't really necessarily convince people. they're in rebellion because of their sinful nature. They picked up offense because it's been taught to them, and they're ready for revolution because it's in their human nature, you know? So I think the gospel is just the solution, right? I mean, we got to know this stuff, but we just got to preach to them the gospel. We got to reason to them with scripture and convict them of sin.
I think a lot of these can be lead-ins to the gospel. In other words, some of these are here and now hot issues. And just like Paul, you know, he'd begin a conversation by finding out what was on their minds. And CRT and the whole, you know, CRT is the reasoning, they call it reasonable, behind the social justice. But social justice is on everybody's mind. Everybody wants to see, you know, they want to outdo the next person on what they call virtue signaling, and showing how they are, in tune with the revolution. And so, you know, I think knowing the ins and outs of the rationale behind social justice equips someone who has the gospel to be able to inject it into the campus, you know. So yeah, you got to go to the gospel, but here's your door. You know, it's in a sense, you're almost guaranteed that every person on the campus has been thinking about this stuff to some level or another. And so you can, for example, you know, what's the solution? Well, it's systemic and so on and so forth. Well, you know, it's really the issue of the human heart. And there's your segue into bringing in the gospel. So, you know, I don't think, absolutely, the gospel is the answer. And the gospel is at the root, at the heart of the solution to this whole problem. So why am I doing all this teaching on this? So that we can connect this issue with gospel principles.
I'm in full support of this education, by the way. It's not an argument against being educated in how to answer it in a sense, in an intelligent way. Here's a scripture that Becky pulled up, Proverbs 17:4. An evildoer gives heed to false lips. A liar listens eagerly to a spiteful tongue. So we have a lot of evildoers, human nature, and they're eager to listen to rebellion, unfortunately. So it's, and the gospel is the solution, although we need to know this stuff because it's going to come to bear at some point, you know.
Oh, I'm going to get into social justice tactics here. And I don't know how many of you printed out the handout I gave you, but it's going to lead into this one proposal for curriculum in Minnesota schools. What are social justice tactics? Well, they're making war on many, many fronts. Sensitivity training. That's been around for a long time. Compulsory re-education and indoctrination. The theory behind so many, and there's a lot of, remember that term useful idiots when we were talking about cultural Marxism last spring? Boy, just about every corporation and any kind of organization that endorses these sensitivity training projects, there's your typical useful idiot. They open the door and allow CRT you know, and this has given a lot of people employment, basically spewing out this philosophy, critical race theory. That's the foundation of so many of these things, sex education, diversity training, the 1619 Project. Are you familiar with that? 1619, that's something that Obama is actually involved in. But basically they're trying to, and they're succeeding as we speak, in transforming the education in American history to portray America as the founding fathers in particular, as a bunch of racist slave owners, and total emphasis on the shortcomings of America, total blackout of the heroic things. For example, the fact that abolition was a case of well-meaning white, northern, largely Christian Americans that were basically for the abolition of slavery. They get neglected. Every fault of any icon in American history is this. We see it. We see it going on with all the statues being pulled down and so on. But that's being formalized into this 1690 project. And I think it's basically a television and video, but for the most part. In the mandated school curriculum, and I got an answer, we're going to take a look at what's going on in Minnesota as we speak. Other tactics, innuendo, threats, shaming, silencing, mob action, we see it going on. So let's take a look. If you got one of those that I sent out to be a handout for tonight, this is the Minnesota K-12 social studies draft. What I'm going to show you is an article that extracts some of the main points out of it to reveal the critical race theory that's behind all of this. Now, this took, it's an article in, I'm not even sure what it is. One of the local media, I think, might even been something like Breitbart or Fox. But it was January 15th, 2021. And it's a critique of the Minnesota Department of Education's first draft of the K-12 social studies standards for the next 2 years. Now, some of you might be thinking, okay, Dan, don't forget you're talking to a homeschool audience. Yeah, I know I am. And but the problem is this affects us, not the, first of all, the reach of government into private schools and homeschools is relentless. And it tries to control everything. We heard a few years ago, it was all on the curriculum. What was the name of that again? Who remembers? See if there's anybody still awake. Totally slips my mind now. But here's the thing. You know, everybody, I was very disappointed with the election, but everybody's in an uproar because we lost the election. But I've always contended that the classroom is where the real battleground is. By the time these people are brainwashed with leftist ideology, it's already too late. They're going to vote by the way they think. Remember that quote we always used to hear from Jeff Myers and the Doc Noble? The philosophy of the classroom of one generation will become the philosophy of government and politics of the next generation. And that's what we saw in this last election. The so many young people have been brainwashed. So if for no other reason, we need to fight. For example, Bunny's sister, Julie, is very involved in the Child Protection League, which fights things like this curriculum you're going to see. Mainly their concern is on all of the trans and the LGBT, et cetera, agenda. But they recognize that, you know, it's like the old adage, if you don't fight the enemy out there, pretty soon you're going to have to fight the enemy in here. And election campaigns a lot of times are a bit late. We should have been fighting this fight back when that generation that's voting now was being educated. So here's what they said. Minnesota Department of Education has released its first draft of K-12 social studies standards for the next 10 years, a proposal that omits most of the significant events in American history and focuses instead on systemic racism and oppression of marginalized people throughout the United States and Minnesota history. So like I say, this is an extract done by someone who agrees with us. And so they're pointing out, they're pulling out things that should be alarming to any traditional value, whether they're even Christian or not, parent. It includes the following standards. Define political, economic, spatial, and historical perspectives and apply them to the boundary disputes and genocide that occurred in the past within the land that is now Minnesota today. Did you know that our Minnesota ancestors are the whites, of course, are guilty of genocide? Now, genocide is a pretty important word. You can't just throw that around. And that's exactly what they're doing. They basically are making a very severe charge against the settlers of Minnesota, calling it genocide. Genocide's got a definition. There's international law that defines it. And I venture that the Indian Wars in America and Minnesota's history do not qualify for genocide. On the other hand, Native American warfare against other Native American peoples could very well have been genocide in the sense of total wipeout. Now, I'm not going to get into a debate on, you know, who was meaner, red people or white people. But the fact is, you know where their focus is here. We talked about this once before. The depravity of paganism is so covered up by the current educational approach, which is influenced by this critical race theory. So, okay, the next one, this is a biggie. So this is a goal. This is a goal every Minnesota student is going to be expected to, by the way, this has not been approved yet, but there are plenty of things already in statewide education mandate that already includes a lot of this stuff. So this is just the latest version, but look at this. The goal, every student will be able to explain the social construction of race and how it was used to oppress people of color and assess how social policies and economic forces offer privilege or systematic oppression for racial, ethnic groups related to assessing social, political, economic, and spatial opportunities. CRT is now part of the standard curriculum in American high schools and middle schools. Basically, what else is that? It's basically raw critical race theory being enforced in Minnesota's public schools. Next goal, some of these are out of order. He didn't put them all in there. His document probably went on for pages. Another goal for Minnesota students.
Hey, Dan.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's interesting, if we were having a debate with somebody about all these things, we would say, I might point out that I'm not here to dispute that you can find substance if you look for it here. But what I'm here is to ask the question, why are they trying to leave out the rest of the story? I like to give this example. I'll just try to be real brief. If I know somebody and you don't know that person, but I know some of their dirty laundry, but I also happen to know that they're an upstanding citizen and they have a lot of they have amended their ways, and their life story really should be defined as a whole by their character and how they are upstanding these days. But in the past, there was a season where they had some crimes, but if I don't like that person, I can just only emphasize their crimes and eliminate all their good deeds and eliminate all their character and only explain to you that they're about their crimes. And that's dishonest. And so the problem we have with this example is that they're removing all the other history and only focusing on the negatives. And it's a distortion. So you get a distorted view of reality. And we always need to point that out, that they're being dishonest because they're distorting reality by only emphasizing the crimes and the flaws in our past and not the whole picture.
You know how this is going to work itself out in a discussion? You're going to say, this is a biased history. There was a lot more good done by the founding fathers and whoever we're discussing. And they're going to argue back, well, you got your bias. And, you're just one of those Trump patriots. You're trying to whitewash all the mistakes. Okay. Well, then it gets down to, you really got to have evidence behind what you're saying. And this is why I've mentioned over and over, this is why I'm so dedicated to tutoring at the homeschool co-ops, because they're gonna be challenged. Our young folks are gonna be challenged to come up with the evidence. For example, I think I used one example about who caused the most wars in history. And we had factual, statistical evidence showing that religion wasn't the cause of most wars. That's the work. That's the grunt work that's going to have to be put into this. Now, typically, a left winger shoots off his mouth without a lot of background evidence. They're getting pumped up with this CRT theory. What I'm saying is, part of equipping the next generation, Maranatha parents, equipping your kids, is helping them understand, you're going to end up in situations where you're going to have to defend certain theses. For example, that America is great, or was great, because of the Christian influence. And you're going to have to be able to give examples, statistics, evidence, and so on. If it ever gets to that, now granted, most of those discussions just end up in a shouting match and people go in their own direction mad at each other. But on the long run, this is a parallel here. I've been doing a lot of reading lately on young earth creationism, and the young earthers have been gaining ground in the debate on how old the earth is, and basically gaining ground and showing the weaknesses of the whole evolution theory. But they do need to have specific evidence to make their case. And so, I don't want to get too far off the subject, but there is a parallel there too. All right, let's see, we got about 15 minutes left here. Let's try and cover at least this thing on the standards for history in Minnesota. Let's see. I'm just going to try and pick a few rather than go through the whole thing. Well, the next one, evaluate the impact of spatial decisions on policies affecting historically marginalized communities of color and indigenous nations, and take action to affect policy. It's not just a case of informing the youth of Minnesota, it's a case of motivating them to get involved in social justice. And you'll see that in a few more of these. define freedom, democracy, and examine how different groups have been included or excluded from the ideas Well, some of these things stand alone, they sound kind of innocent, but when you get a focus and an emphasis on social justice, that basically, and that's part of what this article is about, showing how if you're gonna, you only got so many hours of teaching history in a week, and your choice of what to emphasize or what to talk about is going to have a huge impact on the ultimate message that a student takes away. And so if all the emphasis is on all those injustices, well, what do you think they're going to do? They're going to feel like, whoa, okay, there needs to be some changes made. Here's one. Describe the tactics used by the United States government to claim indigenous and Mexican land, including but not limited to analysis of the ideology of manifest destiny and its relationship to whiteness, Christianity, and capitalism. Three big bogeymen. I have to confess, when I teach about the acquisition of Mexico and in the Southwest, there's reason to question some of the things that went on. There's two sides to the story. We have to, like Parnell said, we got to admit to the shortcomings when they're obvious. And some of that might fit this particular thing. But look what it says. Manifest destiny, that's a big bad thing. That means American imperialism. And its relationship to whiteness, come on, whiteness, that's a totally, to use their own phrase, social construct of critical race theory. And now we got to teach it in our history curriculum. And Christianity, well, we already know capitalism is a bad thing because that's the way it's been taught now for quite a few decades. And let's lump Christianity in there. So, you know, you're biasing your captive audience with this kind of curriculum. So let me just kind of skip down a couple more. Anything on this part that you want to discuss? I just highlighted some of the things that stuck out to me. Genocide again. One of the standards here, develop a respectful awareness about ideas and norms about gender. Let me redo this and write emphasis. Develop a respectful awareness about how ideas and norms about gender have changed over time, how members of the LGBTQ plus community have responded to persecution or marginalization by building coalitions in order to promote gender equity and equality. Is that a mouthful or what? This is what Julie Quist has been involved in trying to fight with the Child Protection League. Basically they're trying to convert our youth to the LGBTQ ideology. It's an ideology. And so they're trying to persuade and change minds. They're not just reporting facts. This one is so clear, propaganda part of the platform. Meanwhile, what have they done? Like I said, when you teach history, you got to decide what to leave out as well as what to include. What are the omits? Pledge of Allegiance, American flag, World War I, World War II, the Holocaust, American Revolution, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Civil War, brave Minnesotans of the 1st Regiment, So, man, you know, you can just see how way, way back when public education became part of Minnesota's or the whole U.S., basically we turned curriculum decisions over to the politicians. And, you know, that was 1820, 1830. You know, so 100 years later, look what we got. 200 years later, look what we got. The campaign added Minnesota Standards Review Committee proposes replacing these major events and aspects of the U.S. and Minnesota history with, here we go. We're taking all those previous lists out. What are we injecting in there instead? Systemic racism in the United States, rooted in our founding, 1619 Project. A few more here. Develop a respectful awareness for the LGBTQ. Boy, that one just frosts me. Sorry, man, but this one frosts me. I'm out ready to come out with some four-letter words. Who are they that think they have a right to take our kids and indoctrinate them with an ideology that's contrary to the Bible? That's what's going on. And and there's the last one, Manifest Destiny, whiteness, Christianity, all these, you know, by guilt by association, Christianity, capitalism, for that matter, even whiteness, you know, throwing all in there and basically disparaged. So this is the rest of the article. Director of Academic Standards, Doug Paulson, dismissed the voices of real Minnesotans by labeling their concerns in the letter as white supremacy language. So people like Julie and, you know, there's other organizations that have been trying to fight this battle against the imposition of critical race theory in the system. And they get blown off as white supremacists. You know, this is so outrageous. And, you know, we need silence is approval. We need to get into this fight. And, you know, I mean, first priority is our own kids. We got them out of this public schools, and, you know, thank God for that. But meanwhile, what are our chances of winning the next election if this kind of stuff is allowed to be preached in the public schools? So let's see if we can wind up this topic here. Any comments or questions on that whole Minnesota history standards thing here? Nope. Okay. See, what do we have here? Time. All right, I'm going to try and wind up. Our author, Scott David Allen, says, social justice ethic is based on grievance and a desire to blame others for the world's problems. It brings to mind this insight from C.S. Lewis. Quote, we must picture hell as a state where everyone has a grievance and where everyone lives in a deadly serious passion of envy and resentment. This pretty well describes ideological social justice. It's got no basis for love, forgiveness, or reconciliation. So the biblical answer to, what was that, question number four? Yeah. The biblical answer was, what's the solution to our problem? The gospel. Confirms your point, Parnell. The gospel. On the Christ, God incarnate bore the punishment we deserve for sinful rebellion in order to show us his mercy we could never deserve. His death on the cross and his resurrection opened the way for reconciliation of all our broken relationships. Scott David Allen says, ultimate social justice is not a social problem, it's a moral problem. Injustice exists because we are fallen, sinful, selfish people. You can change the system all you want. And this is why the suppression of the true history of communism is so harmful. You can change the system all you want, but you always end up with the same fallen human beings. Think of Joseph Stalin, hero of the proletariat. Lenin also, you know, so you wipe out the supposedly guilty ones, members of the bourgeoisie, and then what do you end up with? The most ruthless murderer in the history of the world, and all of the millions of people that died by firing squad, starvation, or whatever else. America was free, prosperous, and great because it accepted the Bible's view of a fundamental problem as human beings. Every class that I teach in economics, government, world history, and American history tries to bang home this important truth. The goods that we enjoy are all because of the biblical perspective, biblical worldview. Man's problem is moral. When man accepts God's solution, he'll be blessed. Psalm 33:12, we'll end on this one. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen as his heritage. That's the reason America was great, still has greatness in it. And it was understood. It was in our history books. You know, you pull up a history book written before 1950 is a very patriotic, God-fearing book. And now they're trying to change it all. So anyway, that means next time we get together, we'll start with question number 5. That's only halfway through this stuff. So I hope you still got it in you to get some more of this. I think the Barnes, you mentioned last time that, you know, it's kind of tedious hearing all this. I think some of the most tedious stuff we've covered here. You know, I can't promise that there won't be some depressing things still to be said, but I think it's necessary. So any comments, questions? I'm seeing it's just about 9 o'clock. And
yeah, I'd like to say some. Very good, Dan. Thank you so much. It's very vital for us to stay on top of this subject and not ignore it. I'm out there twice a week preaching the gospel, and this motivates me to preach the gospel more. Mm-hmm. It just shows you, I mean, what brought us the success we have? It was the gospel, right? It was the gospel's effect on European hearts, for example, that birthed, you know, brought the pilgrims here and birthed the Mayflower Compact and, you know, ended slavery. And I don't, it's just, we need to know our Bibles and we need to be preaching it. And we need to understand this, very important. But the antidote is the Bible. We need to know it. We need to be preaching it, because it will break through all the lies of the enemy, all the deception. It will break through, because truth sets people free. And the Bible is the truth. And so thank you for this. It's good. I'm motivated. And I think that it can sound cliche that the gospel is the answer. It's not cliche. It's the truth. If we have it in our hearts, and if we are boldly willing, if we have it on our lips, and we're ready to give the truth in the face of the lie, it will always win. And people will be converted. The Marxists will be converted. You know, the haters will be converted when they encounter the truth and the grace and the love of Christ in us. You know, it's important that we just delve in, and our identity is not primarily as Americans, but primarily as Christians, as disciples of Jesus Christ. We care about America, but it's the gospel that's going to save us. And so we just got to dig in.
Amen. Anybody else? Well, I tell you, this whole thing has just consumed me. Not in a negative way. I have had kind of a renaissance of finding, I shouldn't say purpose in general, but maybe specifically, I just believe God has put me into this pursuit of understanding on this whole subject. And, it's for whatever effect it has, I don't think I can change course. I just think that God has just got me into this, and I think it's so vital for the next generation. I think that's the bottom line of why I'm so motivated. I think the next generation is at stake here. So
you know, we'll say this: as I've been doing surveys in Kauffman with students, I've been encouraged by the humanity of the people I've been talking to. And I haven't been asking social justice questions, but I've shared my survey when I've opened the meetings before with the church. Some of you are familiar with the questions we ask out there. You know, are you afraid of dying? What do you think about life after death? You know, who do you think, you know, God is? And have you ever experienced hopelessness or depression? You know, is there anything we can pray for you for? But when I ask people what they're passionate about, I haven't found a lot of people that are bringing up social justice. So I think people are a little burned out by what happened last summer. You know what I mean? I think our college students, I might be reading into it. I'm not specifically opening up that can of worms with them because that's not productive for me and what I'm trying to achieve. But I'll just say that, that there's still a lot of room to preach the gospel to these people. They're receptive. Now, they might not be getting converted right away, but we're having these conversations and we're sharing the gospel and they're not turning it down. I think there's a lot of brokenness and hopelessness out there, and the gospel continues to be the solution. So we can be encouraged that we have, you know, the hope of the nations. We have the message and people are ready for it. They need it.
I don't want to keep us. It's already after 9. Somebody like to close this in prayer?
Thank you, Lord, that this series that we've been doing here with Dan is so productive in helping us to get our own thinking together. Most of us just want to just avoid the subject in our minds because it's too big, it's too confusing. But Dan, given Dan the grace to be able to simplify it, place it in our into our vocabulary, into our working understanding of life and the campus and the kingdom. Father, I pray that you continue to bless him and that you give him the grace to pursue this to your fruition, to your fruit, to pursue it to the place where he can be a broadcast station of these truths and help liberate your sons and daughters that seem to be going into bondage from these lies that are being presented. We pray, Father God, that you pour your blessing on all of us to sleep well tonight, our families. Give us the grace to be men and women of God in the middle of this world system. And all God's children said, amen.
Amen.
Okay. Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.
Good night. Thanks, Dan.